gone to Japan and trained under Nagata, who is a person who does only microtia in his life. He doesn't do any other case. He does only microtia. And Mohit has been trained under Nagata, and he has been doing lot of microtias for the last many years now. So he's the only person in our department doing all sorts of microtia work. And I'm sure that he will be able to answer all your questions. And then he should be able to guide us also how you should be answering questions for cases of microtia that is going to come for your MCH exam. As you would all know that microtia, if a case of microtia is there, it will definitely be kept for the examination. And it's not a very difficult case, but because the numbers are less only, maybe many people wouldn't have done most of the different procedures that can be done for this particular case. So having said all these things, I think I will not take more time. I welcome Mohit Sharma to this particular gathering. And I think we will start now.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. And Vijay, you have to introduce yourself, and then you have to actually start off with the case presentation. So after Vijay's case presentation, Mohit would be having a small presentation on microtia, and then he would be having questions also. I've got the list of all the plastic surgery final year residents, and then we will. I hope that all of you would come forth and answer the questions also.
So
by turns we will keep asking.
I'll be asking questions to Vijay, and then anybody else also can answer, or he has to answer. What?
Yeah, Vijay is the primary candidate, and other people also can answer. You can actually, you would be getting the list of the final. I'll put the list of the final year PGs also into your phone, okay. And I think then you would be able to ask them also. You can actually call out the names, and you can ask them also.
Okay.
Right? And after Mohit's presentation, then we would have the short case, the amputation of the year, not the year reconstruction.
Yeah.
Right? Shall we start off then, Vijay? Yeah, fine.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Vijay Babu, doing plastic surgery PG in the Department of Plastic Surgery in Osmania Medical College, Hyderabad. I'd like to start my case. A 13-year-old girl from Ernakulam came with chief complaints of deformed ear in the left ear since birth and associated with loss of hearing in the left ear. She was born to parents who were married non-consanguineously, and she has no history, any antenatal history of exposure to radiation or any drug intake. While her developmental milestones were normal and her emergency schedule was adequate, there's no history of any other congenital anomalies. And she has not received any treatment or surgery previously for the deformed ear. And also there's no history of any comorbidities. There's no history of any addictions. And they give no history of any similar complaints in her parents, siblings, or relatives. Coming to general examination, patient is conscious and coherent and cooperative. And she's moderately built and moderately nourished. There is no evidence of any pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, generalized lymphadenopathy or bilateral pedal edema. There is no evidence of any syndromic features of the face. And I would also look for any kind of cleft lip or cleft palate in my general examination, any urogenital anomalies, cardiovascular anomalies, vertebral examination. Coming to local examination, I would like to examine the face. And as you can see, there is no facial asymmetry. There's no evidence of any chin deviation. There's no evidence of hypoplasia of the mandible, maxilla, zygoma, or mastoid bone or temporal bone. I'd also look for the muscles of mastication like masseter and the temporalis, and also look for any facial nerve involvement, and also any pre or periauricular pits, and also look for superficial temporal artery. I'd also look for examination of the chest. I'd try to look for the circumference of the chest, whether there's any deformity or not. Coming to the examination of the right ear, the size and position are normal. There is hooding of the helix seen covering the anti-helix, so anti-helix is not much prominent, whereas the lobule, tragus, antitragus are normal. External auditory meatus is seen. Preauricular sideband are present. There's no scars or pits. On palpation, I'd like to confirm my inspectory findings and also look for the angle of inclination and also for superior temporal artery pulsations. On examination of the left ear, the helix, anti-helix, scaphoid, conchal, triangular fossa, tragus and antitragus are absent. There is just an ear remnant with hypoplastic lobule, which is malpositioned and at a higher level than the opposite ear. The external auditory meatus is absent. There is probably evidence of low hairline. Preauricular sideburns are present. There is no scars or pits in the periauricular region. On palpation, I'd like to confirm my inspectory findings. I'll also look for superficial temporal artery pulsations. So according to the inspectory and findings, the diagnosis would be non-syndromic left ear microtia of Tanzer type 2A and Nagata type 1 of the left ear, and right ear Tanzer's type 4A and Nagata type 5 with no facial nerve palsy with low hairline. On examination of the right ear, the size and position are normal. There is hooding of the helix seen covering the antihelix. The lobule, tragus, antitragus are normal. External auditory meatus is seen. Preauricular sideburns are present and there's no scars or pits. On palpation, I'd like to confirm my inspectory findings and also look for the angle of the inclination, the superficial temporal artery pulsations. On examination of the left ear, the helix, antihelix, scaphoid, conchal and triangular fossa, tragus and antitragus are absent. There is an ear remnant with hypoplastic lobule, which is malpositioned at a higher level than the opposite ear. The external auditory meatus is absent. There is evidence of low hairline. Preauricular sideburns are present. No scars or pits in periauricular region are seen. On palpation, I would like to confirm my inspectory findings and look for the superficial artery pulsations, temporal artery pulsations. So my diagnosis would be non-syndromic left ear microtia of Tanzer's type 2A and Nagata type 1. And right ear would be Tanzer's type 4A and Nagata's type 5 with no facial nerve palsy with low hairline.
Okay. So I'll ask you later. You just carry on.
Investigation.
I can just ask him now?
Yeah, absolutely.
You see, Nagata, first of all, you can stick to one classification. Okay.
Okay, sir.
In exam, there is no need to tell two classifications because that's going to confuse you as well as the examiner.
Yes, sir.
And you will be more confused. Okay.
Yes,
so,
sir.
I would say for all practical purposes, Nagata's classification is good because it is telling you your approach to the surgery.
Yes.
Okay. So can you tell me the Nagata's classification?
Yes, sir. Nagata has classified into five types, sir. Type one is a lobular type where there is a malpositioned lobule and there is no tragus, antitragus, no acoustic meatus. Whereas type 2 is conchal type, where there is a prominent concha. At the same time, the lobule, concha, tragus and antitragus are malpositioned. The third is small concha type, where the concha is very small and only a small indentation is seen. Whereas type 4 is anosia, no ear. And type 5 is atypical, which doesn't fall under any of the above four.
Okay. So, that's fine. Right ear is... Actually, you may not call this right ear a microtic ear as such. There is a ear deformity, but the right ear may not come in type of microtias because it's a minor deformity in the upper part,
which can be the helix,
which can be corrected. So that's okay. Yes. If this case is given, it will be good if you just stick to the diagnosis on this left side. You are just telling, although there is a deformity on the, if it's a long case, you will be definitely telling both the sides. But if it is given as a short case, you will be just telling about the left side, which is the lobule type microtia. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And could you also elaborate on Tanzer's classification?
Yes, sir. Tanzer's classification is given into five types, where type one is the anosia. Type two is complete hypoplasia. either with atresia of the external artery canal or without atresia of external artery canal. Type 3 is where the hypoplasia of the middle one-third of the area is involved. And type 4 is again hypoplasia of the superior one-third. Again, it is divided into A, B, and C, where A is a constricted type of ear involving the helix, and B is cryptopsia, where some of the cartilage is beneath the scalp, and type C involves the whole of the superior one-third. And type 5 is where ears are prominent ears.
So I would say for academic purposes, and especially for operating purposes and decision making, Nagata classification suits us very well. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So you can stick to that. Okay, go ahead. Sir. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. On coming to investigation, I'd like to do a bilateral ear examination by ENT and also bilateral audiometry. I'd like to do a CT scan of the head and neck to see the status and development of the middle ear and the internal ear. I'd like to do a CT chest to see the cartilages, whether they're calcified and are they adequate. And also like to use a Doppler to also map the superficial temporal artery. And also investigations which are required for surgical workup and anesthesia.
Now I'll stop you here. You see, for a typical microtia case, this is a 13-year-old girl. Okay.
Yes.
Do you expect, would you do CT chest in this?
Yes, sir. Ideally, 13 years is enough for maturation of the costal cartilage, and I would not expect any calcification. But another role would be to if we can get a 3D model of the costal cartilage, which would help in making the framework, sir.
Now I dismiss that. You can do that, but that is superfluous.
Yes.
Okay. The CT CT of the chest is indicated only in adults where you expect some ossification. And
yes,
you would like to know which side is more ossified. So you don't want to waste just unnecessarily and money of the patient. You would do CT in an adult in which you expect some ossification, and you would like to choose the lesser ossified side.
Yes.
Other than this, you won't do CT chest. Now, CT scan of the head and neck. If some major anomaly is there, then only you would like to go for the CT scan of this head and neck. Otherwise, audiometry should suffice, just that too also for documentation.
Yes.
So if I ask you, for all the unilateral microtia patients that are coming to you, you have audiometry has to be done at the time of birth itself to know that the ear is normal. The other ear is hearing is normal. Okay. Thereafter, for operation, there is no need of audiometry.
Yes, sir.
So another thing, if I ask you that, would you like to know about the hearing of the left ear and would like to go for canalplasty in this particular
No, sir.
Case?
No, sir. Because I'd like to do the ear reconstruction so that the local tissue is not hampered, which is required for my ear reconstruction, sir.
Okay. After that, would you like to go for canalplasty?
No, sir. Because she's already using the other ear, it is not advisable to go for plasty of the.
So suppose if the patient is having a highly demanding profession, use of ear is very important for her. So in that condition, she insists that she has to go for canalplasty. So what would be the indication? When would you do canalplasty?
It should be done always after the ear reconstruction, sir.
Okay. No, you have done the reconstruction, but even then, there has to be some criteria on which you will base whether this is a patient is reconstructable or not.
Yes, sir. Based on the development of the middle ear and the internal ear, sir.
Okay. Any name?
Well,
any name for any criteria is there?
Sorry, sir.
There is in this new text, new Nelligan text also, they have mentioned it. But there is Professor Jasdorfer.
Yes.
In Virginia, USA, he has developed a criteria So you do 1 millimeter slice CT scan of the affected ear, and then for the structures present, you give them marks.
Yes.
So for the presence of stapes, for incus, for malleus, for mastoid pneumatization, for middle ear aeration, everything gets 1, 2, 1, 2 numbers, and then total 10 points are given.
Yes,
and in a unilateral microtia, you have to have minimum 7 points to be able to proceed for canalplasty. Otherwise, it is not done, even if the patient wants. So another question, if the patient is not fit to be done for canalplasty, then still the patient wants improvement, what would you do?
Improvement in hearing can be done by hearing aids, sir.
Yeah, that can be done, any particular type of hearing aid you will. You can use bone-anchored hearing aids.
Bone-anchored hearing aids.
Okay, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Now, coming to this patient, she's the problems that have to be addressed are a low hairline, which can be managed with preoperatively laser if more than one-third of the upper part of the ear is involved. The right ear appears constriction, for which a simple otoplasty can be done. The left ear for microtia, I'd like to do reconstruction of the ear with Nagata's techniques using autologous costal cartilage.
Okay. So, what is the minimum circumference of the chest which is required as per Nagata's guidelines?
So, at the level of the ziphy sternum, sir, it should be a minimum of 60 centimeters circumference.
Okay. So, which side of cartilage you will take?
In Nagata's technique, ipsilateral side is taken, sir.
Okay, that you take with the perichondrium or without?
No, sir. The perichondrium is left intact so that it can develop. Only the chondrium without the perichondrium is taken for reconstruction.
So, what is the technical term for this?
Extra perichondrium.
No. You call it subperichondrial.
Subperichondrial, yes.
Okay, so these are basic things. When you are just talking, the basic things, the concepts you have to remember. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
So what would you, how would you proceed?
Yes, sir. The first thing is I will counsel the patients regarding the procedures that are available and also take consent and explain the complications that will be associated. And in planning the Nagatas, first, I'd like to make a template using the normal ear. In this way, we should mark in OHP sheets the helix, anti-helix.
Just a minute.
Yes, sir.
In Nagata's technique, you don't make the template based on the normal ear. Okay. There are standard templates. So only use of normal ear is to determine the size of the template.
Yes.
But template is not based on normal ear. So if you are saying you are using Nagata's technique, then it is a preformed template which can be magnified or you can reduce the size. And how would you determine the size of the template?
Yes, sir. Size of the template can be done by measuring the distance from the root of the helix to the natal canthus of the eye and at the tip of the lobule to the oral commissure, sir. This distance gives us the height, sir, of the lobule of the auricle and also the position and angulation at which it has to be kept, sir.
No. You are not talking. You are talking about more about the positioning of the ear.
Okay, sir.
I am asking about the size of the template for the affected size, for the affected side has to be determined seeing the normal side. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Not the shape of the template, only the size of the template.
Size.
So you take in the Nagata's technique, you can magnify the templates, the standard templates, which are there in the textbooks. the book chapter which is written by Nagata, there is a standard template. You photocopy it.
Okay,
you put it over the ear, normal ear. And it should be just 4 millimeter less in dimension anterior posteriorly, like from the top to bottom.
Yes.
So why 4 millimeter less?
Because we tend to cover it with fascia, it will appear bulky, sir.
No, it is not covered with fascia in the initial stage. It is the thickness of the skin.
Okay, sir.
So the thickness of the skin will add 4 millimeter. 2 millimeter up, 2 millimeter down, so that will make it equal size. So you, if the ear is of 60 millimeter, then you have to take 56 millimeter.
I'm sorry, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
You are, I have, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Then in Nakata's technique, the standard template is used, sir. Then I'd like to also see the position, how it has to be kept, the inclination, which is seen, which is the parallel to the nasal profile, and also the distances from the root of the helix to the lateral canthus of the eye, and also the tip of the lobule to the oral commissure, sir.
Okay. Any other thing? Hello? Can
yes,
you hear
sir,
me?
Yes, yeah, yes yeah. I can hear, sir.
Any other thing? In suppose if the patient is having heavy facial microsomia.
Yes.
And that size of face is much more constricted. So, you see, if the one size of the side of the face is slightly smaller because of the hemifacial microsomia. So, how will you use all the parameters?
Yes, sir.
So, basically, can you answer that?
No, sir.
Okay, should I answer that? Or somebody else will answer that?
Anybody else is answering? There's so many final year PGs, no? Who's going to answer? Okay, I think Mohit, you can just...
okay.
Yeah.
You see, if the affected size is smaller, the side with microsize is smaller, then you cannot use the same parameters based on the other side. Otherwise, the ear will look very posterior.
Yes.
So you just have to take a parameter. It should be the root of the helix should be approximately 20 millimeter behind the sideburn, or at least one index finger of the patient. It should be one index finger of the patient behind the sideburn of the patient to look normal.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So you are checking it in all the dimensions, from the lateral canthus, from the angle of mouth. You are just measuring the distance. If considering it is normal, then you are seeing the height of the thing also. You will make the patient lie down, and you can put a bucket handle or a spectacle to see whether the height of the ear that you are going to reconstruct is also appropriate.
Yes.
So you just make the patient lie down and take a small bucket handle and then just keep it straight and match.
Yes, sir.
And check the position in relation to the sideburn also.
Okay, sir.
To have a normal position.
Yes, sir.
Normal looking position on the affected side if it is slightly smaller. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, sir. So once the template is made, I would like to reverse it and try to position it to the affected side and try to get the approximate position based on the distances and the angulation on the affected side. And the next thing would be to, using the template to form a framework. And ideally in our institute, we are guided by a professor to use available things like potato to carve and practice it. So here what we do is, once the template is made, we form a base plate using the template. This template base plate has the anti-helix and the scaphoid fossa, And then using this, we also make the
Just a minute. Tell me again, what are the structures? And first you tell me what cartilages are taken.
Yes, sir. In Nagata's technique, in ipsilateral side, cartilages 5 to 9 are taken. 5 to 9.
No. You will take the whole chest.
No.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
6 to 9, sir.
Okay. 6 to 9. Fine.
6 to 9 cartilages are harvested, and the synchondrome of the 6th and 7th is used to make the base plate, sir.
I'll just tell you how to go about it. You see,
yes,
you should be, when you have mentioned one technique and you know that you are being asked about that technique, we have not gone to other techniques. Okay. You just say specifically, I'll give a transverse incision, 5 centimeter, okay. 5 or 6 centimeter transverse incision. And before the incision, I'll like to see the elasticity of the skin, whether it, you just move the, you put your hand on the marked incision and move it up and down, and you should be able to cover the lower most margin of the chest, so that that shows you whether you will be able to access the lower most cartilage. Otherwise, you reposition your incision. So you give incision, and is this a muscle cutting or muscle splitting incision? So there is a muscle, not cutting, it is a splitting incision.
Splitting, yes.
Yeah. So you split between external oblique and rectus.
Rectus.
So you don't damage any muscle. You give tumescent. Then you create a skin pocket. Then you split the muscles. Then you access the cartilage and take it subperichondrially. So yes, I answered half of your thing. Now you have taken the cartilage.
Yes.
Okay. Now, which cartilage you are going to use for what?
Yes, sir. The C6 and C7 is used to make the base plate of the framework, and C8 is used for the
Vijay, can I just interrupt you? Can you just, yes. Your presentation is coming as a very small thing. Actually, your picture only is coming. Can you just get your presentation to the one?
You can close it and again come. You can close and again come.
Okay, sir. 1 second.
Okay.
Is it full screen now, sir?
Yeah.
For me, it is still same, but I am able to see.
Mohit, what you have to do, in this one, you have to just go to that. You could actually see his presentation. No? So you just go there. One pin mark would come. So you just click on the pin mark, then that will become big.
Oh, yeah. Got it.
Yeah.
Fine.
Okay.
Go ahead.
C6 and C1 cartilage are used to make the base plate of the framework. C8 is used to get the helix. C9 is used for anti-helix, sir. And the remnants of the cartilages can be used to keep for the elevation of the framework for the second procedure, sir.
Okay, that's fine. What other drawings you have drawn, this tragus, you see, you are combining two different
things.
This is a Furman's technique of P1, P2, and its tragus shape is, so that's okay. Leave that thing behind. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. So once the cartilage is carved, sir, I would like to fix it, sir. This is the way.
Hello, Sandeep.
Yes, Mohit.
Somebody muted Vijay. I am not able to hear him now.
Oh, Ankita, can you unmute Vijay?
Yes,
yeah,
sir.
Vijay, now we are able to hear you. Yeah.
Yes. Is it full screen, sir? No.
Yeah. Tell me.
Yes, sir. Once the cartilages are carved, sir, Nagata's technique, the anti-helix is placed over the appropriate place in the base plate, and also the helix, sir, to make it prominent, sir. And this is again the other type, sir, Furman's type. Here the tragus and antitragus is also fixed, and also the projections, the P1 and P2s?
Okay. You see, all I'm saying, this is a potato practice that you are doing.
Yes, sir.
So that's as a first first practice, this is okay.
Yes.
But you have to refine it.
Yes.
Okay. You have to definitely, it will be refined. You just go ahead. We can't discuss the technique. We'll discuss the technique. If at all possible, I can show you some video also. But you just ahead.
Yes, sir. So once the framework is made, sir, then we decide on the incision.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Sandeep, lot of people are saying that they can't.
Saying they're not able to see the presentation. No. Vijay, can you just check out Vijay? Yeah, you have to actually Vijay from your end that.
Actually, Ankita has my presentation. If she can go ahead, is Ankita?
Ankita, can you just run Vijay's presentation?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah, Vijay, you go ahead, Vijay.
Yes, sir.
We'll get your presentation up.
Okay, Vijay, then go ahead.
Yes, sir. Once the framework is made, sir, I would like to insert it into at the by making a skin pocket, sir. By incising, sir, by
I'm hearing.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, both of you are audible.
Yes.
Yeah, now I think.
So can you see now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, we are seeing.
Yes, sir. After the cartilage is framed, sir, I would like to insert it at the right position, measuring the measurements I have taken in the skin pocket that is created subcutaneously without damaging any subdermal vessels, sir.
Vijay, can you tell me where to stop?
No, actually, it's almost the end, ma'am. That's it. That's it.
The last one?
Yes, yeah, that's the only thing.
Okay.
So that's for the technique and for the practice, this is okay. You have to know the important things that you have to know is you should be able to draw the incision for the Nagata technique.
Yes, sir.
So now the thing is, I cannot tell you in this presentation the incision for the Nagata technique. What I can do is that I can show you some presentation and what all you should be covering. You have covered most of the things in the history, but we can very rapidly go through it so that you know what all you need to know.
Yes.